Hi, I'm Vanessa Green, and I'm co-founder and CEO of Fin6. I'm from Denver, Colorado. I studied biology at Dartmouth College, did some consulting at the Monitor Group in New York before returning to MIT for environmental engineering, where I fell in love with entrepreneurship, continued at Sloan, and started Fin6.
Hi, I'm Tony Segneri, and I am co-founder and CTO at Fin6. So I grew up in Syracuse, New York, and I did my undergrad in electrical engineering at RPI. And then I spent about half a dozen years as an active duty intelligence officer in the US Air Force, at which point I decided to go back to grad school. So I ended up at MIT, where I did my master's and PhD in very high frequency power electronics.
So Fin6 was a company founded out of MIT back in 2010. We make miniature power supplies. So the best way to think about that is y'all have a laptop, the brick on the power cord. We can make it just a little bit bigger than the iPhone charger, and it'll still do 65, 90 watts, whatever you need for your laptop. So that piece of electronics is in every electronic product. And these guys developed some technology that allows us to make it really small and high performance. I came to MIT really interested in energy and water issues. And I actually didn't have any exposure to entrepreneurship when I arrived at MIT. I didn't realize that people like me might have the opportunity to start a company. And I came in a program very much like this. The class was called Energy Ventures, and I was exposed to a whole bunch of people really passionate about making an impact by commercializing technology.
So Fin6 is technology. It's really a bet, because the sort of currency in power supplies is switching frequency. The faster you can switch, the smaller you can make the thing. And so if you think of having a big bucket, which is full of water, which is your energy source, and your laptop sitting over here to the right, which is your load, you take this little bucket and you dip it into the big bucket, and then you carry it over here and dump it on your laptop. And so if your laptop wants like a gallon of water per minute, you could move a 1 gallon bucket once per minute, or you could move a 1/1,000,000th of a gallon bucket a million times a minute and get the same amount of water. And that's what we do. We figured out, how do we move the bucket really fast so it can be really tiny without spilling any water? So the reason it's better to have a million buckets traveling a million times a minute is that the bucket itself is small. It's electrical energy storage. So inductors and capacitors, these are real things that take up space and cost money in the power electronic system. And if you can store less energy each cycle, then they can be smaller. And that dominates the size, weight, and cost of the system. So if you can shrink those things, you win.
What we do in our systems is basically take the energy that normally you would throw away, and we hold it within the system so that each cycle we lose a little bit less energy than other people, which means we can go a lot faster and still be really efficient, which means everything could be really small.
Yeah, we lose a lot. We lose a lot less energy than people normally do, which is how we go a lot faster. They can feel the relevance of it by taking that heavy adapter that's currently weighing down their bag, throwing it away, and dropping a nice little Fin6 one in there, and they don't even know it's there. We sat around in the lab for a while and thought about what applications might be possible, did a little bit of, you know, analysis and said, hey, we think this is real. And then we said, but we ought to, you know, figure out what to do about the business side of things.
So I was in the New Enterprises class. Like I said, I was really interested in starting a technology-based business. And one of the things that happens at Sloan is Sloan students like to work with their friends. So a lot of them had formed teams together with people that they knew they wanted to work with. But I was really interested in the technology side, and I'd seen the idea. And I knew it came 23rd. But I was also pretty confident we could make it work. So I sent the guys an email that said, hey, let's grab a coffee and talk about it. When I read through the post, it was clear that they'd done quite a bit of work and that there was a technical foundation, some IP behind the idea, and also that there was a team pretty passionate about it. So at first it was just one guy. You know, originally one guy posted the idea and I was like, okay, I'll see what this is about. But then when there were three people that were clearly all hooked on this idea, I thought, I need to learn more about this because there's clearly something behind it.
And the key was, you know, is there something that we can push into? And for us it was, we thought, hey, you know, cell phones, envelope tracking, everybody wants a cell phone that's the same size but has, you know, 3 or 5x the battery life. And so we saw that as a reason that the technology could be commercial, with the understanding that eventually we'll be able to put it all over the place. So envelope tracking is the ability to take the voltage rail for the RF power amplifier in your cell phone and follow it really fast. So a normal power supply is kind of slow. It's designed to create a constant voltage, because that's what they do. But if you can track the voltage that an RF power amplifier actually needs to use in real time, then you can increase the efficiency a lot.
So this was an interesting idea, and I knew it from the beginning that it was interesting, but not knowing anything about the mobile space, I didn't know what other people were doing. And what we found out was that there was a number of startups who were well-funded and about 3 years ahead of us that were solving that same problem in a different way, but were gonna be to the market before we could have anything out.
Everybody's feedback was, you know what, there's like four major players that are startups already. The space is saturated with venture capital, so it's gonna be hard to raise. And the market is really vertically integrated. The cell phone guys only play with certain people, so you have to find a way to break into that channel. We really had no idea how to do that. And we're like, all right, there must be like a less hardened market that we can go after. And that sort of naturally led us to the next thing, which was LED, because LED is this big frothy brouhaha of like possibilities.
So I remember a day we were sitting around in the data center, and not coming from power electronics or, to be frank, really understanding anything about envelope tracking at that time, I was sitting with these guys and I'm like, okay, so what else can this stuff do? And they gave a couple of examples. They said, well, the best way for you to think about it is, you know, the brick on your laptop, our stuff can make that really small. I was like, oh, well, that's pretty interesting. That's one market to think about. Where else do I use those things? And one of the things that came up was LED lighting. And around that time, there was a lot of grant proposals out, so we could see that there was interest in that space. And so we thought, let's learn a little bit more about both of those markets and see which one, if either, really makes sense as a first market for our company. One of the things that we found about the LED space in particular is that it was a very new space, so that there was a lot changing very quickly. And in that environment, power electronics were becoming a big bottleneck. LEDs were getting cheaper, systems were getting higher performance, and the power supply was becoming the kind of most expensive, bulkiest part of the system. So we said, here's a new market, it's high growth, and power electronics is a bottleneck for that space. We can solve that problem, so let's focus on that.
Why did we end up doing something else other than LED? You know, that's a pretty complicated answer. And the reason I would say is that if you start at the top level, like what is the lighting industry anyway? You know, it's this thing that's been, for at least 100 years, there have been electric light bulbs floating around. And so now, even though LEDs make a lot more sense in fixtures, everybody's trying to make an LED light bulb. And that is a problem, because an existing light bulb is 50 cents. Everybody thinks of it as a throwaway commodity. But an LED light bulb as it exists today is probably about 20 bucks of LEDs and metal chunks and power electronics packed into a package and assembled. And so right away you create this huge mismatch, because the public perception is, I buy a light bulb, it's supposed to be cheap because I'm gonna throw it away in, you know, 6 months or something. But here it is, this light bulb that is made out of LEDs, it's gonna become a piece of infrastructure because it's supposed to last for 25 years. And so you have to overcome the mindset. But that actually turns out to be really hard, and I would argue the LED light bulb industry hasn't done it yet, not successfully, because nobody wants to pay 15, 20 bucks for an LED light bulb, even though you can do the math and show, yes, yay verily, this is actually better. It's cheaper for me, it performs better, I should like it. But public perception is hard to change. The technology is new, and it's not ready to compete at, like, in a fully commoditized, high-pressure market like this at these cost points. And so we sort of had to back up and say, well, what are we going to do? Because we can't cross a bridge where the margin is literally like a couple of percent, because the pressure is so high to compete with something that's with 100-year-old technology, and the market at large, the industry at large, hasn't figured out how to re-vector the public perception in a way that makes the technology more feasible to introduce.
So it's not that we have, you know, it's not that we don't believe this technology is a fit for LED lighting. It's just that it's not as good of a first market as we'd hoped, because the margins don't exist there as they did when we first started looking at the space.
Yeah, and that's a hard lesson too, is that you don't necessarily get paid for the value of the thing you're creating. You get paid for what the value that the market assigns to it. And in an industry like lighting that's been around for so long, the market has preconceived notions of what constitutes value. And you know, I guess that's where the cost of marketing comes in, is like, how do you change an entire society's perspective on what a light bulb is or should be?
And that kind of marketing is not something Fin6 was going to invest in. So we needed to be in a segment where people saw value in small. And that's why we got excited about the laptop adapter space. And it's funny because we joke about it, because from the beginning, even when I first came on this video, the first thing I said to you is, the best way to think about what we do is, it makes your laptop bricks small. So everyone has always been able to connect it. They explained it to me that way. I explained it to you that way. And clearly there's some value there. It's something people want. And so when we kind of got down to the crux of it, it was like, okay, let's find a place where people will pay for what we do. Laptop adapters is that space. There is a segment of the market that's, you know, high volume travelers. They don't want to put their laptop adapter in their purse. It's something that's been kind of a burden for them for a number of years. They got a sleek Ultrabook and they got a brick to go with it. Let's solve that problem. And we've been off to the races since we made that shift. Starting a company isn't easy. There's tons of ups and downs, and you have to have a certain set of kind of shared values and a belief in the other people you're building that business with. And I saw that in these guys. I really believed in them. And it was someone who I could see wanting to build something with. Finding people to talk to as you're looking to validate your market is one of the most important things you have to do early on. And they don't have to be ultimately who's going to be your customer, but it has to be potential customers. So people in your network, in your broader network, the MIT network, maybe friends of your family, anywhere you can go, LinkedIn, Facebook, find people out there who are working in the sector. And reach out to them. And we got some really good advice about kind of how to do that and how to be approachable and make it easy for people to talk to you quickly. So like, let's do a 15-minute call, just get a little bit of feedback on what we're working on. And you know, you get about a 50% hit rate, so you got to keep trying. A lot of the time you'll reach out and, you know, four people in a row won't get back to you and you'll feel like, oh man, this is too much. But just getting a couple good conversations helps you build a foundation for having stronger conversations with other folks. And it certainly helped us as we were kind of forming out where we wanted to focus initially. So if you're taking this class, what I would tell you more than anything else is, go ahead and try it. Entrepreneurship isn't easy. There's ups and downs, but you can do it. Think about your product, talk to some customers, find out who cares about what you believe in, and build something that matters. Anyone can be an entrepreneur, and if I can do it, you can do it.